While walking around my neighborhood in Austin, I saw this advertisement on the back of a U-Haul.
Now, I don't know about you, but when I think of U-Haul, I don't think of aerodynamics. So I'm gonna put their claims to the test. I'm gonna make U-Haul go hypersonic, but not this U-Haul.
I'm going to make this U-Haul go hypersonic.
Yeah, depending on how things are going, we've got a mechanism. We might even be able to just cut this loose in an empty test section and really see how dynamically stable this guy is at Mach 7.
This is the stupidest video I've ever made.
So, I'm on my way to the University of Texas, San Antonio, about 2 hours south of here. They have an extremely rare piece of equipment, a hypersonic wind tunnel, managed by none other than Dr. Chris Combs, who you may know as the laser-eyed hypersonic professor on Twitter. Dr. Combs is currently using it to test control mechanisms for hypersonic vehicles traveling in the upper atmosphere. I'll let the man himself explain the difficulties in controlling a hypersonic vehicle in the upper atmosphere.
When you go up high altitude, all right, you get high enough up in the altitude where control surfaces like flaps and fins don't work anymore. There's not enough drag, there's not enough aero force for that to happen. But you still need to be able to move around. And so usually we use control jets. And so like the space shuttle, a lot of space vehicles, you see those using the little RCS that fire. And when you're out in space, like properly in orbit, you're not worried about interaction of aerodynamics that's happening with that. But there's some middle ground where you're high enough up in altitude where the flaps still aren't effective, but you're low enough where you have aero forces happening. And then suddenly you have this hypersonic airflow hitting your jet, and it rips the jet apart, and you lose effectiveness. And NASA has even seen that for certain tests, you imagine from a Newton's laws perspective, you fire a jet one way, you move the other way kind of thing. That interaction gets so complex that sometimes you fire the jet and you move the same direction.
That's a major problem for the new wave of hypersonic aircraft being developed. You may be surprised to learn that ICBMs travel much faster than any hypersonic vehicles being developed. Intercontinental ballistic missiles are designed to exit Earth's atmosphere, travel extremely quickly at speeds of up to 7.8 kilometers per second through space, and then suddenly dive on their targets. They move quickly, but their lofted trajectory gives their enemies more time to detect and aim anti-missile defenses. Hypersonic missiles are designed to cruise within the Earth's atmosphere at about half the speed of an ICBM. The atmosphere slows them down, but their low trajectory means they suddenly appear on the horizon, previously being hidden by the Earth's curve, giving their targets minimal time to detect and intercept them. So this hypersonic wind tunnel is an extremely useful tool for companies and government agencies looking to develop hypersonic vehicles. An extremely useful tool that we are going to use to test a vehicle designed to move your old furniture across the country at Mach 7.
So it will go, it'll face this way because airflow is this direction. I'm assuming you don't want this going Mach 7 in reverse, right? So it'll get mounted facing like that, somewhere in the middle, right? Yeah, hey, maybe that's a stretch goal, depending on how much time we have.
We do have multiple of them.
Yeah, so it's gonna sit right here like that. Should we go ahead and unbox this guy?
Yeah.
Is it, yeah.
Someone's gonna get it.
Yeah, we're gonna upset a collector somewhere. I'm sorry. Whoever's out there watching this, that's a U-Haul model collector.
It has the original price on it of $7. Man. I got it for $40.
With inflation, who knows how much that's worth. Okay, so yeah, we're gonna take the flat plate out. Gonna be mounted like that on the Sting. Eli, you got a demo for us for what kind of Sting mount we're probably talking about?
This is our variable angle of attack strut that still has a cowl on it from a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
We'll need to mount because this has a quarter 20 thread in the back. So we'll need to figure out how to mount the U-Haul.
Yeah. So we'll gingerly remove that cowl, I think.
Poor thing.
Yeah, exactly.
That's nothing that the vets don't do to you. That's when I decided not to be a vet.
That left a mark.
I went on a house call and they're like, this is what your job is now.
Yeah.
The results for that cow are excellent. Groundbreaking bovine technology. So, how does this wind tunnel get air to travel at Mach 7? On one end is a big old vacuum chamber, and on the other is a pressurized tube. The two sides are separated by a metal diaphragm that is designed to pop at a target pressure differential. You would think that increasing the pressure would increase the speed of air traveling between the sections, but it doesn't.
One other little nuance is people think that you can, if you increase the pressure, that should increase the Mach number, right? That kind of conceptually makes sense. Our Mach number is actually fixed by the geometry. It's just all about expansion ratio. Mm-hmm. So changing pressure just changes the Reynolds number and the mass flux and the equivalent altitude that you have, but the Mach number is 7.2, basically regardless of what diaphragm that we use. And that's fixed by this shape.
That shape is the shape of the nozzle, which works exactly like a rocket nozzle. Rocket nozzles work by speeding up exhaust gases from subsonic speeds to supersonic speeds in the converging section, hitting Mach 1 at the throat, at which point the physics do a 180 turn in rules.
And so what happens is, it's just like traffic on the interstate. If you put I-35 down to one lane, everything stops, all right? Everything's going slow. You add lanes, 3, 4, 5, 6, everybody's able to speed up and spread out. Air molecules do the same thing once they're going faster than Mach 1.
My friend, not just bikes, might have some arguments for that.
Yeah, right. you could expand this out more and go higher Mach number, right. But then you get limited on the expansion end because the pressure's getting lower, the temperature's getting lower, and we're actually already pushing the limits of like rarefaction with this. So the reason that we have insulation there on that piece of pipe behind you is because we actually heat up the air. So these are big cables to that power electric heaters that are wrapped around this pipe. And then we have insulation on it so you don't burn yourself, and it also keeps the heat in. All right, we can heat this pipe up to 700K, 800F.
What's the purpose of heating it?
But so that the air doesn't freeze in the free stream. Because even when we heat, the free stream air basically equivalent temperature, like if it was the, if
and
you were in
of the
upper.
Expansion.
It's the expansion. So the energy has to come from somewhere. You can't cheat, right? And so that energy is all going into the momentum and the velocity of the gas, but you lose the pressure, you lose the temperature. So it all gets sapped out from
what
that
effect
side.
Would that have on the test with,
well,
it wouldn't literally freeze, I assume.
Yeah, so what happens is, really you scale it out with like Reynolds number, right. Basically. And so it's on the one end, the pressure being low is more of an altitude consideration. But then you have temperatures that aren't realistic.
Right.
All right. And this is a problem in a lot of hypersonic facilities that we have too, because this is still a cold tunnel. Mm-hmm. We heat up to 700K and that's still cold because the free stream equivalent air temperature that we get is 60K. All right. So minus hundreds of degrees.
Yeah, yeah.
It's cryogenically cold. Really, and that's just above the liquefaction point. All right. So you're really just heating so that.
So you're actually keeping it above the liquefaction.
Yeah, exactly.
So
that's all you're trying
to
do.
Liquid.
Yeah, so it won't turn to, it won't basically, you know, you won't get condensation, you won't start to have things turn into liquid. And that's really all we're going for. Because to get a true flight enthalpy, we'd have to heat up to 2000K or so, which you hit material limits for stainless in your driver tube pipe, things like that. So there are very few facilities that actually operate that way. You have to go into a completely different mechanism to run those types of tunnels.
So, in summary, this machine essentially builds a pressure differential between the vacuum on one side and a long pressurized tank on the other to drive air through a converging-diverging nozzle. This pressurized side is designed to be as long as possible because a longer tube equates to a longer test. The test may occur in the blink of an eye, but with a high-speed camera, we can capture a lot of data when a long column of air is traveling by instead of a short one. So, onto the test itself. But it wasn't all smooth sailing. When we started to pressurize the system, some pressure gauge readings started to glitch out. And this was a big problem, because those pressure gauges were needed to trip the camera trigger box.
Without the triggering box, we have to manually get the camera to record when it's supposed to.
Right.
And we have basically a 1 second window of camera buffer. So Eli is either gonna fix the trigger box while in the like 40 minutes that the vacuum is getting pulled down, or if he can't fix that short, then
We're gonna sit here, and then when we hear the diaphragm burst, smack the trigger button, and that should catch it.
Okay.
So, that's the status right now.
And so began a mad scramble by Eli to find the source of the problem. We knew the problem was being caused by a short circuit, so it was a matter of unplugging everything until we could track down the faulty part. With only 40 minutes before the test was due to start, I was clearly anxious. But with all hands on deck and Eli's understanding of the machine, we did manage to find the culprit and proceeded to smash it.
There we go, we got some shrapnel.
For the last hour and a half.
Freaking microcontroller.
So it's just the Arduino board was broken?
Yeah, it was running the code, but it was not outputting a voltage.
Okay, so you just replaced
Just popping a new board. Worked fine.
With that, we could finally get the tunnel up to pressure. But first, we had to lock the place down for safety.
Now, last thing I'm gonna do is to let the surrounding labs know that we're gonna pressurize. So we have a laser bell that will ring to let the other labs know.
A laser bell?
It may not be obvious there, but when I heard laser bell, I assumed it was some sort of overcomplicated sci-fi laser-actuated bell and was clearly confused.
A laser bell.
Only to slowly realize that it was in fact just a normal bell to tell people a laser was in use.
Oh,
it's three short
to tell people that there's a laser in. Okay.
So lasers will blind the shit out of you. Enough?
I'm not sure doing this on camera stuff was the right call. At this point, we just had to wait for the pressure differential to get high enough to burst the diaphragm.
Now we just hope it doesn't get to 300 and like not burst. And then we're like, what's going on?
These diaphragms with this score depth can burst safely to like 320 PSI.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'd trust the model to survive it. 320 PSI burst.
Yeah.
So.
Have we been?
It is. Burst. So, okay.
That was not the sound I was expecting.
Yeah.
I was expecting a bit more of a boom than a prolonged fart.
Yeah. It's like a big metallic fart. Yeah.
Yeah. So I turned off the buffer tank so we're not still pushing air through there. If you want to turn off the write to file just so we don't. Save excess data.
Wait. So hang on. Will you do this bit?
Yeah, absolutely. All right.
I want to lose
so
the
I'm
data.
So I'm going to stop the write to file, then I'm going to turn off the vacuum pump. And then before we all go out there, I'm going to poke my head out, do a safety check.
So the group of overexcited nerds headed outside to review the high-speed footage.
Okay, there goes the release. So it's flying now. Oh yeah, this is great. We've got the bow shock set up. Oh, this is perfect.
What?
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Did we get it stable?
We got it. The U-Haul's stable.
Oh my God.
Oh, it's starting to tip down now.
Oh, that's incredible.
Did it go down?
Oh my God. Stable in flight.
Yeah, it's starting as the more it tips down, the more it's catching the hood.
Yeah, right.
Unfortunately, the viewing window for the test is pretty small, but in the words of Dr. Combs, I don't know what we learned, but I'm excited. The two bow shock waves result in some funky shockwave interactions. On our static test, where we fixed the truck in place, the cab vibrated wildly. Which honestly, the fact this little plastic model held up to a hypersonic blast of air is impressive. So, with all this data, we do get an idea of how a hypersonic U-Haul may behave. So, I had our wonderful animator Eli create an artistic depiction of what a full-scale hypersonic U-Haul test may look like. Science, it's a wonderful thing. So what did we learn? That Dr. Chris Combs is a fun guy, that hypersonic wind tunnels are pretty neat, that I need to learn to speak more clearly on camera, and that U-Hauls are absolutely not designed for hypersonic flight. But the thing I'm most curious about, what became of the U-Haul model? We may need to wait a year or two to find that out.
And then, like I said, hopefully, you know, maybe we try a free flight test. That could be a lot of fun.
What will actually happen? So you just let it go and it just flies back? Is there a mesh back here or something that will catch it?
No, it's going to go
into
the vacuum tank.
You know,
there's a graveyard of models down in the bottom of that right now, and periodically we get an undergrad to go fish stuff out. It was funny so this vacuum tank was custom. There's this company in Ohio that makes vacuum tanks like this, and when I called them, to one of the conversations we had where we were, you know, kind of specking this thing out, and I said, hey, could we put some extra access flanges on the side? And they're, oh yeah, sure, no problem. Said, how big? And then I'm kind of just thinking out loud on the phone. I was like, about how big do you think it would need to be for a student to fit their arm inside? And they're like, what are you making, man?
I was like, who's our smallest grad student?
Yeah, right.
Into this thing.
Yeah. I do joke that it's big enough to fit grad students in there that have misbehaved, you know, as sort of a threat.
So, if we've learned anything, you don't want to misbehave in Dr. Combs' program, but you can still learn from him in the safety of your own home. I've uploaded our uncut tour of the hypersonic wind tunnel to Nebula. It's over 27 minutes long and full of fun moments that I would have loved to have included in this video.
I think I should open the video with this is not sponsored by U-Haul.
Yeah.
But got cut down to package a video more suitable to the YouTube algorithm. Relatively higher paced and not dwelling too long on any singular point. You can get access to that now with a huge discounted price of just $250 a month using the link in the description. This money goes directly to our team. We do our best to give back by uploading early and ad-free. This video has already been on Nebula for over 2 weeks, and the next episode of Real Engineering is now on Nebula 2. Detailing the incredible engineering behind Japan's new magnetic levitation trains. We also upload exclusive bonus videos like this uncut interview, and upload original documentaries like our Logistics of D-Day series and the Battle of Britain series. But it's not just my exclusive videos, it's your other favorite YouTubers too, like Mustard, Practical Engineering, Neo, and Wendover Productions, all for the price of just $250 a month. I've done my best to push the envelope of what YouTube can be with in-depth engineering videos, but there are some small things I need to sacrifice in order to succeed here. I used to explain equations completely in older videos, variable by variable, but I could see in our analytics that I would lose 50% of the audience during those moments. Now I just show you the equations and allow viewers to pause if they have interest. Now we have spikes of attention in those moments. On Nebula, I don't need to worry about things like this. It's where our biggest fans watch our videos. The ones that aren't bored by slower, more in-depth videos. That's why I upload uncut interviews like this there, because people actually want to watch them on Nebula. So, if that sounds like you, please sign up and support our channel for a massively discounted rate of just $250 a month.